worship in one accord.
Every praise,
every praise,
every praise,
every praise is to our God.
Sing hallelujah,
sing hallelujah to our God.
Hallelujah.
Glory, hallelujah. Changing, Everything is different now.
Here comes the sun, piercing the clouds. You're closer than you think you are,
closer than you've been before.
So look to the sky.
Let's go ahead and lift your hands to the Lord today. Hallelujah. I said, it's not over. It's not over. I don't care how bad the situation looks. It's not over till God says it's over. Right? Amen. I said, it's not over till God says it's over. I was just thinking, it was brought to my mind, God was dealing my spirit just then about in the book of Acts, Peter was taken captivity. He was put in jail by the religious leaders of the day. And it looked pretty bleak for the church. But the Bible didn't stop there. The Bible said, but the church made prayers. They all come together in unity. And the Bible said that God heard their prayers and sent an angel. And the Bible said that the angel went into the jail, loosed his bands, brought him out, and sent him back. I want to tell you today, that, you know what? I know it's pretty bleak. Things look real bad in our society today, even just this week. And many people probably don't know this. They just superimpose, or however they do these things, a picture of the Hindu goddess Kali on the Empire State Building. Now, I've done a little research of who this goddess, so-called goddess Kali is. She's a goddess of death, destruction, and rebellion. Now, if we as Christians would look at that, we could get all discouraged, right? But at the same time, we are in the book of Revelation right now. This is the church's greatest hour. This is where the church rises up. It looks like we're in bondage. It looks like Peter's in bondage. But all the church has got to do is pray. And when the church begin to praise, God's going to send deliverance. And I want to tell you today that they can superimpose whatever they want to superimpose. They can do whatever they want to do. But I read the back of the book, and we are the winners. We win in the end. Hey, all we got to do is be faithful. This is our greatest day to be alive in the kingdom of God. Hey, I wouldn't ever want to be alive any other time, even in the book of Acts. But today is the greatest hour that we are to live in. And it's not over. I want to tell you something. I know things look bad, but it's not over. It's not over, Saint. I want to tell you something. We need to pray. We need to repent for our country and pray like never before, because God's got deliverance coming, not only for us, but for our country and for the people across the world. This is the greatest hour. God has promised us a great revival. And if God promises something, He will deliver. Praise God. I'm thankful for the grace of God, and I'm thankful for the faithfulness of God today. In Jesus' name. If our ushers will be helping this morning, we're going to get ready to receive our Sunday morning offering. No, you've been standing quite a while. We're going to get you set down here in just a minute so you can stand back up. We want to give a special shout out or greeting today to all of our guests today. So glad to have you in service with us this morning. If you will, Saints, why don't you go ahead and put your hands together and welcome our guests today. And obviously, so glad to see all of our saints here. We got a good crowd out on this Sunday morning, worshiping God like you are, looking for something good to come from the preached word of God this morning. Amen. Amen. We have a prayer request we might like to make known before the Lord this morning. Sister Della Rose and Brother James Williams is in need of a touch this morning. And I'm sure across this congregation, there's many people that's here this morning that you have a need as well. And if you'd like to make that known before the Lord this morning, you can do that by raising your hand however you feel. And we're going to ask the Lord to touch these needs, also to bless this offering this morning and bless the giver. In Jesus' name, we love you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for healing power. Thank you for virtue, God. Thank you for faithfulness, God, that you said you'd never leave nor forsake us. Even in our times of need and distress, God, you're there. And we pray today, God, that you'll touch Sister Della Rose, Brother James Williams today, across this congregation today. God, their needs has been brought before you by the uplift of their hands. God, you know right where they're at. And I pray, God, that you will touch these needs. God, we're giving you the praise, the glory this morning. In Jesus' name, God, we ask you that you would also, that you would bless this offering, God. Bless it to the edification of this church, God. We pray, God, that you would bless the hand of the giver this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you will, won't you follow the lead of the ushers and give as unto the Lord this morning.
From day to day, it will Praise God. Praise God. You may be seated. Praise God. I'm going to sing, but I'd like to testify if I could just a couple of minutes here. I may testify longer than I sing. I don't know, but I guess that'll be all right because I just have something on my heart here. About 2 years ago, a little over 2 years ago, I was in an accident in a truck, and I was attempting to move a heavy container, and the chain broke, and I was in the truck, and it bounced up and down three or four times. I don't know how many. I lost count. And I was in there. I didn't have to have a seatbelt on because I was in a job site. And so it bounced me up and down in there like a toy. And somehow I managed to get out of the truck, got on the ground. I couldn't get anybody's attention, and so I was just thinking, I'm desperate, I got to do something. So I just rolled around on the ground, and a policeman saw me. He came up with blue lights and said, what do you need? I said, I need to go to a doctor. I need a hospital. I'm in bad shape. I don't know what's wrong, but I'm in bad shape. And before he got there, I was just rolling around, and I intended to, like, roll around two or three times and then stop, but I just couldn't stop. I was in so much pain. And I was just saying, Lord, help me. Jesus, help me. Jesus, help me. Jesus, help me. And he was working already, and I didn't know it. And they carried me to the hospital, x-rayed my back, and said, we're sorry, Mr. Lemons, but you're going to have to go to the med. Well, I know what the med is. And, I mean, my heart sank because I knew there was more damage back there than I thought. I thought maybe a strain or something. Well, the end of the story is, I had three fractured vertebrae and one compressed. I had to be in rehab. I had to be in the med a week. I had to be in rehab for 3.5 weeks. I was just like a baby when I came out of the med. I could do nothing for myself. I was in a lot of pain. But all during that time, God was taking care of me. He was watching me. I know a lot of you folks prayed for me. A lot of y'all came to see me. God was just moving on the scene for me. And I've been wanting to come up here and testify about it for a good while, but it just never seemed like the right time for me. But I just want to share this. When I was through with all of my therapy and everything, the doctor, I had to go in and talk to the doctor, and he told me, he said, well, you're about 85% of what you were before this. And he gave me some limitations. He said, you can't pick up over a certain amount of pounds. Never get on a ladder. Never, ever get on a ladder. And he said, don't do a lot of things that are repetitious that will strain your back and make it weaker. And I went back to work, and I'm on a different duty, which is a little lighter, I consider. And anyway, God did all that. And I've been up here a lot of times, and I've just thought, can I take my time, brother? And I just wanted to show y'all what God did do for me. And I wanted to show visibly where I am now. And with the doctor saying I'm 85%, I know this is different. I know it's different, but I just want to give God that 85% right now, okay? Hold on. Now, I'll be sore. I'll be sore, but I'll sure feel good because I gave God praise. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I had occasion 2 weeks ago to take my two younger daughters to St. Louis, and we got up in the Arch, which is we saw a movie about how they made it. It's really amazing how that thing is put together. And they put the very last piece up there in the top, before they did, they had to adjust the legs, which are made of concrete, steel, rebar, all of that stuff. When they built it, they had to build into that a way to adjust it, even though it's anchored in concrete. And I got thinking about how God's blessed me and taken care of me. And you know, he puts in our soul an adjustment to where if we will let him, he can mold us. So this morning, I want to sing a song to him. If you want to, you can just close your eyes and worship with me as I sing to him. It's track 6. Would somebody like to put your hand up and praise God? Hallelujah. Glory. I tried wonderful, marvelous, incredible too, unbelievable, inconceivable, but these words just wouldn't do. See, they all fell so short when I tried to convey the greatness of my Jesus, so I'll just have to say, I just can't find the words to really express the greatness of Jesus. So I must confess, I tried big words and small words, but none that I've heard could describe him. I just can't find the words. I took down my dictionary, I searched it all through, I did a lot of looking in some other books too, but when my search had ended, I'd come right back around to what I knew right from the beginning, that no words could be found. Lord, I can't find the words to really express the greatness of my Jesus, so I must confess. I tried big words, I tried small words, but none that I've heard
find the words. Oh, I'd like to describe him, but I can't find the words. I'd love to describe him, but I can't find.
Oh, that's right. Let's worship Him. Let's worship the Lord. Oh, there's nobody like Him. Oh, He deserves our worship. He deserves our praise today. Oh, thank you, Jesus. That's right. Everybody praise the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, who alone is worthy. Oh, Lord, we love you. We praise you. Thank you, Lord. Amen. It's good to be in the presence of the Lord today. It's an honor to feel His presence and to be in His presence, and I'm so thankful that He's here. Amen. Can we give God more praise right now? Oh, I feel a move of the Holy Ghost in this place today. I feel a move of the Spirit of the Lord in this place. God, we love you. We thank you. We're going to be going shortly to the book of 2 Samuel, chapter number 9. Do have a few announcements to make. We have a fish fry September the 4th that's prepared by the sheriff. It's $11 a plate from 5 to 7 here at the church. And that is to help the men's ministry. If you'll remember that, we have tickets you can buy. And all of the men who are going on the trip, we need to meet with you after service for just a few moments. And I might also mention on the 25th, if you are involved in any ministry, in any capacity on the 25th, that's a Tuesday night, we have Todd Smith and Kaneo Resources that we're doing a video conference with. It'll begin at 7 o'clock. It's 1 hour and 5 minutes, and we would like for you, if you can, to be involved with that. Also on the 26th, which is a Wednesday night, and on the 30th, we have Bishop Treadway, Buck Treadway from Beaumont is going to be here. The senior adult and the young adult classes will be staying together on the Wednesday night, and then he'll be with us in our Difference Maker session in our two services on Sunday. So remember that. If you have made a building fund pledge, we need you to do that. The last couple of months, some of you have not made your pledges, and we rely on that to take care of our responsibilities. So we're giving you a little bit of warning as this month is coming towards a close so that you can prepare for that, and we can take care of our responsibility. And we certainly appreciate that. Amen. Remember the Push Pay. We've made it as convenient as possible for you to give. You can download the Push Pay app on your phone, your Android or iPhone. And you can search for Bethlehem Church and get all of that information. And we made it as easy as we can for you to be able to give. Amen. I want to say a very special thank you to Brother Sanford Churchill and Brother Danny Barber for helping us get our gym floor refinished. Thank you guys so much. It looks awesome. Thank you for that. Amen. I want to say thank you to the Gray family for moving the playground and helping us get that set up. Playground back here. And Brother Brad, thank you for the projector. We appreciate that. And there's a lot of other things that go on, but I want you guys to know how much I appreciate that. I don't know if you noticed in the vestibule this morning, there is a bench out there. Brother Wilson has spent a lot of time over the summer, and he made benches for our school, and they look awesome. Thank you, Bishop, for your hard work. Thank you for what you've done. We appreciate you. Amen. We appreciate you. And I am so thankful. I'm so thankful to be in an apostolic church. Amen. Where we preach and teach the apostles' doctrine, repentance, water baptism in Jesus' name, and the infilling of the Holy Ghost. I am so thankful that I've been born again, and I'm thankful for the goodness of God that's in my life. Amen. God has been so good.
He's been so kind. The book of 2 Samuel chapter 9, I know you've been standing for a while. Let me read 6 verses and then I'll let you be seated. And it's a message I began a few weeks ago, didn't get through it, didn't get to some of it. So I'm going to try to finish it, at least some of it today. And David said, "Is there yet any that is left of the house of Saul that I may show him kindness for Jonathan's sake?" And there was of the house of Saul a servant whose name was Ziba. And when they had called unto him, when they had called him unto David, the king said unto him, "Art thou Ziba?" And he said, "Thy servant is he." And the king said, "Is there not yet any of the house of Saul that I may show the kindness of God unto him?" And unto Ziba, and Ziba said unto the king, "Jonathan hath yet a son, which is lame on his feet." And the king said unto him, "Where is he?" And Ziba said unto the king, "Behold, he is in the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, in Lodabar." Then King David sent and fetched him out of the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, from Lodabar. Now when Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, was coming to David, he fell on his face and did reverence. And David said, "Mephibosheth." And he answered, "Behold thy servant." David said in verse number 3, "Is there not yet any of the house of Saul that I may show the kindness of God unto him?" That I may show the kindness of God unto him. I want to preach about the kindness of God. Lord, I thank you for your goodness and your mercy. I thank you for your people. This is your church. These are your people. They're called by your name, filled with your spirit. I ask you, Lord Jesus, to let the anointing of the Holy Ghost have its way and do its work. Help me, God, to do what you've called me to do today. Help me, Lord Jesus, to relay the message you put on my heart. And God, I pray that you would confirm your word with signs following in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. Give the Lord a praise as you're being seated. Thank you for standing. It was a bittersweet day in Israel. It was a day of death and also a day of hope. On this particular day, a kingdom changed hands. Saul died against the cold steel of his own sword. His once promising life ending in a crimson pool of his own blood. The man who was once the anointed of God, a hero, a man head and shoulders above all the men of Israel, now lies alone in a forsaken field as his enemies advance on his body. When they find him, they're going to disrespect his remains and hang his corpse as a trophy on the wall of the city of Bethshan. Through the tears of the nation of Israel over their fallen king, from his death is born a new era, a beginning, a new day, if you will. For a new king has already been anointed by Samuel. The prophet of God has anointed David, the shepherd boy from the tribe of Judah, the son of Jesse, has been anointed by the Lord. This is the day of transition from Saul to David. The death of the old man makes way for the new man. And so it is in the spirit. It takes the death of the old man to bring a new king to the throne of somebody's life. The kingdoms of Saul and David are a contrast of the highest order. Saul was symbolic of everything Israel had done wrong. They wanted to be like the other nations around them, and they ate the bitter fruit of their folly. Nothing good ever happens for God's people when they desire to be like the world. That was a good place for an amen. I'll say it again to give you one more shot. Nothing good ever happens for God's people when they desire to be like the world around them. Saul was rebellious. He was carnal. He was lazy. He was proud. The kingdom of Saul led Israel down a path they should never have traveled. He disobeyed a direct commandment from God. When the presence of God was lost, he never asked about it. He was content to live without the Lord. He inquired not of it, the Bible said, all the days that he reigned. He didn't even ask about it, let alone go after it. Saul then made it his mission to destroy David. He hated David because David was anointed and called by God. David is the absolute opposite from Saul. David is God's warrior. David is full of faith. He is a worshiper. David will fight giants based on faith, while Saul cowers, afraid and fearful. David is a worshiper. He's most happy when he's praising the Lord. David was not content to live without the presence of the Lord. His first task as king was to say, "How shall I bring the ark of God home unto me? For we inquired not of it in the days of Saul." David's heart was after God's own heart. The Bible said that he followed hard after God. So what we have are two opposing kingdoms. One kingdom is content without the Lord. The other kingdom is passionate about the Lord. One kingdom is in rebellion against God. The other kingdom is building places to worship God in. Amen. It's not at all dissimilar from the spiritual realm that we live in today. There are two opposing forces in the spirit realm that's going on in this world today. One kingdom, the kingdom of Satan, like Saul's kingdom, hates anyone and everyone who is anointed and called of God. Amen. It's in rebellion against God and wants to hinder the work of God. Yes, it does. So by the time we come to our scripture reading, Saul is dead and David assumes the throne. It was a common practice, and I realize that for those of you who were here a couple of weeks ago, this is a rehashing of something that you've already heard, but if you'll bear with me for just a moment, I pray that we'll get somewhere. So when Saul dies and David assumes the throne, it was a common practice in the ancient cultures for a new king to purge the kingdom of all the vestiges of the previous regime. History is littered with the bodies of those who were destroyed during a transition between kings. Amen. Later in Israel's history, the kingdom would be rocked by a civil war, and the rebels would destroy every member of the former king's family except for a boy by the name of Joash. Joash was just a child, and for 6 years, Joash was hidden in the temple to protect him from the assassin's blade. Even family members were not safe when a new king came on the throne. Herod himself, the king in the time of Christ and afterward, had his own sons put to death to prevent them from taking his place as king. So now, with that history as a backdrop, David ascends to the throne of Israel, and Israel expects a purging of everything connected to the house of Saul. Anything that could be connected to Saul waits to be destroyed. But David decides that his kingdom is not going to operate like the kingdom of Saul. He's not going to operate with the same value system as Saul did. David will not attempt to purge everything connected to Saul to keep his own kingdom in place. David makes it his mission to find someone from the house of Saul that he says that I may show the kindness of God to them. Different value systems. One raised under Saul, but now David is the king. Different backgrounds, one from the house of Judah and one from the tribe of Benjamin. But David is not going to wield a sword against the house of Saul. He's going to set a different tenor for this new kingdom. And David begins his reign like this. He goes to a servant of Saul by the name of Ziba, 2 Samuel 9:3. And the king said, is there not yet any of the house of Saul that I may show the kindness of God unto him? Is there anyone from the other kingdom that I can show God's kindness to? Saul's kingdom had disregarded everyone else for self's sake. David's kingdom respected others even when they didn't deserve it because of their actions. Saul mistrusted, alienated, and disregarded everyone who was not like him. But David determined, I'm going to find somebody from the kingdom of Saul that I can show the kindness of God unto him. Amen. It's one thing to be kind to your brothers and sisters and to people who act and think like you do. It's one thing to be kind to people that share your value system, your beliefs, your convictions, and your God. But it's an entirely different event when you find someone from another kingdom to show the kindness of God unto them. Amen. Here's a mentality I want to put in this church's mind this morning for just a few moments, that it is the job of the new kingdom to always be looking for somebody to show the kindness of God to. Amen. I wanted to preach this a couple of weeks ago, and I didn't get to it. But may I tell you that this church should always be looking for somebody that's from the other kingdom. Amen. We're in the kingdom of God. We ought to be kind one to another. We ought to be nice to each other. We ought to love one another. You should always be kind to your church family. And we need to keep doing that. But I'm telling you that we as a church must make it a mission to find people in the world every day that we can show God's kindness to them. Well, praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. There's nothing worse than a Christian who is too holy to be nice and smile at somebody who's not like us. There's nothing worse than somebody that claims to know the love of God that can't be kind to somebody that's in the world. It's the job of the church to show the kindness of God to everybody, whether they act like us or not, whether they think like us or not, whether they share our convictions or our God. It is our job always, always, always to be looking for somebody to show the kindness of God to them. Hallelujah. That's revival preaching. Because what's going to start a revival in our community is when God's people show the kindness of God to people that don't deserve it. Mercy is not for people that deserve it. Mercy is for people that don't deserve it. And I'm going to tell you that the house of Saul had done everything it could to destroy David. Saul had hunted David like he was a dog. And if anybody had the right to say, we're going to put an end to that entire kingdom, it would have been David who had to live in caves to save his own life. But when David came to the throne, he said, my job and my mission is going to be to show kindness to people that are out from the other kingdom. I'm telling you, it's our job to show this world God's grace and God's love by showing kindness to them. Whether they believe in our God or not, we're to be kind to them. Whether they live our lifestyle or not, we're to be kind to them. Whether they share our convictions or not, it's our job to find somebody to show the kindness of God to them. God help us. Oh, I wish I had somebody that knew that whether they, look, they may be a drunk on the street, but you got a job to show them the kindness of God. They may be a crack addict or a meth head, but you've got to show the kindness of God to them. Whether they're a Christian or not, it's our job to show the kindness of God to everybody we come in contact with. Praise the Lord. Everybody in this church must adopt the mentality of the new kingdom. Is there somebody that I can show the kindness of God to? That person that's so ill at work all the time that nobody wants to go out of there, nobody wants to spend any time with them, go out of their way to be around them. It's your job to show them the kindness of God. That person that's always wanting to argue and fuss over the doctrine, over the truth, and all they want to do is fight. Don't get in an argument with them. Just show them the kindness of God and go on. That person that's disappointed you, that person that's hurt you, that person that's come against you, you just show them the kindness of God and go on, because that is the theme of the new kingdom. That's the theme of the new kingdom, is to show the kindness of God to people that are from the other kingdom. I wish I had one person just wave your hand and say, that's my job, is to show the kindness of God to people. That's what we do. We're always looking for somebody. David went out of his way to find somebody to be kind to. He had to go so far out of his way that he had to track down a man by the name of Ziba and say, is there anybody I could show the kindness of God to? Is there anybody from the house of Saul? I know Saul tried to kill me. I know Saul went to witches. I know Saul did all of that. I know he was an embarrassment to the community. I know all of that about Saul. But is there anybody of the house of Saul that I could show kindness to? And Ziba said, there's a boy by the name of Mephibosheth. He's down in Lodabar at the house of Machir, the son of Amiel. He's way over there. And David went way out of his way to show the kindness of God to somebody from another kingdom. I'm going to tell you that it's time that the church goes out of their way to show this world the kindness of a God that loved them enough to spread his arms and die on a cross for their sins. It's time that we go way out. Come on, somebody. Yeah, I know we want to just come and just patty cake and just be in our little old church service with everybody that acts and thinks like we do, but there's a world out there that needs a church willing to go out of their way to meet them at their need and to show the kindness of God unto them. Oh God, help us to be a church that goes out of our way for people from the kingdom of darkness, because they've got a soul and they need God. Is there anyone I can show the kindness of God to? I'm getting to another place in the message. I'm trying to get there. When we're at church, every single one of us who are born again should look for a guest to be kind to. Every young person should go out of their way to connect with every other young person that comes to church, whether they're a guest, a member, an inactive member, somebody who's never been here. Every single adult ought to find somebody to show the kindness of God to. You can talk to your friends and family anytime. You can talk to your friends and family later. But our first move should be to find somebody to show the kindness of God to. When we're out in the community, at work, at school, in the marketplace, we should be looking for somebody that we can be kind to. It may just be a smile or a hello that changes somebody's direction. When you have a guest come with you to church, take the responsibility for bringing them to meet me or one of our other leaders. Sometimes I can't get past the first pew for 30 minutes. I'm answering questions and all kinds of stuff. So you may have to bring them to me. But go out of your way because I need to meet them. I want to meet them. I often go around during altar service. Now, just let me deal with some stuff for just a second. I'll get back to preaching. But a lot of times after altar service or after church, I'll go up and say, hey, go talk to so-and-so. We got somebody over here. Nobody's talking to them. Hey, there's somebody over there that's a guest. I need you to go talk. Look, that should never have to be done. It should be in our mind. It should be in our mind. I got to find somebody to show the kindness of God to. I got to be aware. Come on, I'm preaching to you this morning. I want us to be aware. I want us to be aware of people that we need to show God's kindness to. Go out of our way. Well, they're all the way over there, and my friends are over here. Go out of your way. If you got to go all the way to the house of Machir, the son of Amiel in Lodabar, to show somebody the kindness of God, then you just go out of your way, and you do it. Can I preach a little bit more this morning? Just a little bit more. I have to make it my mission to show the kindness of God to others. Look, our ushers and greeters, they do a great job. They're working hard before and after services. They're trying their best. They need the rest of us to allow them to do their jobs without us taking their time all the time. Come on, look, let me just, they don't want to be rude to anybody, but they have a job they're trying to do. I was told a few weeks ago there were guests here that couldn't get to the ladies at the information booth because so many people were gathered around it just talking, church people. We got to be aware. These folks, they're working. They don't want to be rude to their family and friends, but you got to let them do their job, folks. Still love me? I hope so. Let me go one more step. From the moment a guest drives onto our parking lot, the entire body of Christ is responsible for showing God's kindness to them. Not just the ministers, not just the greeters, not just the ushers, but everybody in the body is responsible for showing the kindness of God. Hallelujah. If it was Wednesday night, and it was just us, I would say it starts with how we prepare the property, mowing, weed eating, picking up trash. Don't walk by a piece of trash on the parking lot when you're walking in church. Pick it up, throw it away. How we take care of God's property reflects how we feel about God and how we represent God. Oh, Lord Jesus. Here we go again. Here we go again. It's good preaching, though. I'm just telling you, we got to do it sometime, don't we? We got to do it sometime. We need to understand that we have a mission. The new kingdom has a mission. I've got to show the kindness of God. I've got to show somebody. Is there anybody from the house of Saul that I can show the kindness of God to? How we greet and communicate with our guests shows the kindness of God. David the king was not too busy or too good to show God's kindness to someone from another kingdom. This boy by the name of Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, was lame on his feet. He couldn't walk right. Look, people in the world can't walk with God because all the things going on in their life. But just because they can't walk right can't mean we can't show them kindness. David didn't worry about his walk. He just wanted to be kind to somebody. We give God our best. We give God our best by showing his kindness to everyone else. Mark Twain said this. I think Samuel Clemens said it too. Kindness is a language which the deaf and blind can read. Kindness is a language which the deaf and blind can read. Saul's kingdom said, worry about yourself. But David's kingdom said, let me find somebody to show God's kindness to them. We should never forget what it was like when we were living in Satan's kingdom. We were all born into a carnal, worldly kingdom. Human nature is selfish, sinful, and carnal. But though we were born into a carnal kingdom, We have been born again. Thank God. Thank God I've been born again. Oh, hallelujah. Thank God he found me while I was in that other kingdom. Thank God he found my family while we were in that other kingdom. Thank God he picked us up out of that miry clay when we were lost and undone, when he had no reason to do anything for us. He found me when I was living in sin. He found me when I was in membership of the other kingdom. This King of glory came and found me. Amen. Amen. I was born in a carnal kingdom, but I've been born again. Praise God. 1 Peter 1, 22 and 23. Seeing ye have purified your souls in obeying the truth. I got stuck here the other day, but I'm going to tell you, the only way to purify your soul, I'm going to say it again. The only way to purify your soul is to obey the truth through the Spirit. You got to obey the truth. You got to obey the gospel. You don't join a church. You got to be born into the church. Amen. The right hand of fellowship isn't what you need. You need to be born again of the water and the Spirit. It purifies the soul. Praise God. Amen. That by obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren. When you really are full of the Holy Ghost, when you're really born again, when your soul's really been purified through obeying the truth, you get an unfeigned love for the church. You get a love for one another. See that you love one another with a pure heart fervently. Amen. I'm going to tell you, we ought to invest more in getting along than we do in fussing with each other. We ought to invest in each other with a pure heart fervently. Amen. I'm going to try my best to get along with my church family, being born again. Praise God. I'm glad I'm born again. Not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God which liveth and abideth forever. I'm glad I've been born by the word of God. I'm glad I've been born of the Spirit. Praise God. This seed is not corruptible. It's incorruptible. This book is the truth. I'm going to tell you, Jesus Christ is the only true God. And the only way to be born again is to be repent of your sins, be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, and be filled with the Holy Ghost. I'm born of the Word of God. Let me go on just a little bit further. Can I do that? Let's go to the book of Titus, chapter number 3. I'm almost done. I've had a lot of pages of notes, and I'm on my second to last page. So praise God. It doesn't mean a thing, hardly, but I thought I'd make you feel a little better. Titus 3 and 3. For we ourselves, everybody say me. We ourselves also were sometimes foolish. Go ahead and admit it. It's true. We ourselves. Look here. Don't forget where the Lord brought you from. Don't just say, man, that person's a mess, because you were a mess too when he found you. Don't just say, well, that person does this and that. You did too before he found you. He said, we ourselves were sometimes foolish, disobedient, deceived, serving divers lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. The apostle said, look, we were all there before. Let me tell you, there's not a single person in this room that didn't need the blood of Jesus Christ to cover your sins. There's not a single person in this room that didn't need the mercy and the grace of God. Amen. He said, we all ourselves, we all been there. We've all needed God's grace and mercy. Every last one of us were sinners that needed the grace and mercy of God. Oh God, help me to remember how far you brought me. It's not I don't have a problem praising him when I look back down the road and remember what he brought me out of and what my life should be like and what the path I was going down. Oh God, I thank you. I praise you because I was that way. I was foolish. I was disobedient. I was deceived. I was serving lust and pleasures and malice, envy. That was me, God. Anybody else can just admit that was me. I was lost. I needed a Savior. I was messed up. I needed God. Hey, that was me. I was in Lodabar. I was far from God. I couldn't walk right. I was in the other kingdom, but his mercy came and found me. Glory to God. Glory to God. Somebody that remembers what it was like when you were lost and miserable and how good it is to be born again ought to just wave your hand and praise God and thank Him. It's a good life. Hey, I'm joyful because God's grace found me. Oh, somebody ought to praise Him for how far He brought you. Because that verse, look, that verse was me. That verse was me. I was lost. I was far from God. I was away from Him. I was in sin. What was it? He said, verse 3, he said, we ourselves. Say, that was me. And look at by, he said, it was you too. We ourselves. Oh, I know we're all dressed up. I know we're all cleaned up. We're all holy and everything. Oh, I know we are special. We're the apple of His eye. We in His hand and nobody can pluck us out. We are so awesome. We're so holy. That old world is so smelly. I'm glad I'm not like, it's like the Pharisee. That little woman's just praying and saying, God, I need you. And he says, Lord, I'm so thankful I'm not like them. I'm glad I'm not like that person. Oh, I'm glad I'm not like those people out there. Look, it's good to do that, but you need to remember that we ourselves also sometimes were foolish, disobedient, deceived, serving divers lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. What was it that changed them from that condition? What was it that changed them from being foolish, disobedient, deceived, serving lusts and pleasures, living in malice, envy, hateful, and hating one another? What was it that turned them around? Verse 4. But after that, the kindness and love of God our Savior toward man appeared. It was the kindness of God. It was the kindness of God that found you while you were a drug addict or an alcoholic or just in false doctrine and sin. It was the kindness of God that found you while you were disobedient and hateful and hurtful. It was the kindness of God that found you and picked you up. Oh, God. Look, if God showed me His kindness when I was that way, the least I can do is show God's kindness to somebody else that's in the same condition. Because it might be the kindness of God through you that turns somebody else around. It was the kindness of God that appeared to me when I was lost, when I was a sinner, when I was away from God. It was the kindness of God that reached down and picked me up out of the miry clay, that set my feet on a rock. Thank God it was the kindness of God that caused a man to get in the pulpit and preach to me, repent, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. It was the kindness of God. It was the kindness of God that got you out of the bar room, that got you off of dope. It was the kindness of God that got you out of false doctrine, out of dead religion. It was the kindness of God that picked you up, that turned you around. It was the kindness of God. Oh God, I thank you for your kindness to me. Is there anybody thankful for the kindness of God that turned your life around? Oh yes, I'm almost done preaching. I'm almost finished, but I've come to say, God, thank you for being kind to me. When I was yet a sinner, you died for me. Thank you for looking ahead in time while you were on that old rugged cross and seeing somebody that needed your kindness. It was the kindness, he said, after the kindness and love of God, our Savior, toward men appeared. Can I read the next verse? Not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to His mercy, He saved us. Whew. Hallelujah. I didn't save myself. I didn't turn myself around. It wasn't the power of positive thinking that got me out of my mess. It wasn't me just deciding, hey, I'm going to do better now. No. It wasn't by works of righteousness that I did, but it was according to His mercy. He saved us. Praise God. The kindness of God saved us. How did he do it? By the washing of regeneration. Praise God. And the renewing of the Holy Ghost. I have come to this congregation today to tell you that the kindness of God is calling everyone in this place to a renewing of the Holy Ghost. Praise God. Hallelujah. Can I preach a little holiness to you right now? Can I tell you? And look, I started a lesson Wednesday night about holiness unto the Lord and how that God is calling us to live holy. And I believe that. And I believe that. And I'm going to keep believing it. I'm going to keep teaching it. And I'm going to keep preaching it. But let me tell you something. That part of holiness is getting a renewing of the Holy Ghost. Part of being holy is being able to come to God with your hands up and letting the Holy Ghost baptize you one more time. I've come to tell you that the kindness of God has come to Bethlehem Church this morning because God wants everyone in this place to get a renewing of the Holy Ghost. You don't have to live off last week, last month, or last year's experience. You don't have to live off 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, or 20 years ago. God wants us to have a renewing of the Holy Ghost in this place today. It's the kindness of God. He wants you to talk in tongues again. Come on, I'm preaching about a revival right now that sweeps over this congregation in a renewing of the Holy Ghost. You ought to make up in your mind, I'm not walking out those doors till I get baptized with the Holy Ghost one more time, till I get a renewing. It's the kindness of, come on, I'm telling you right now, God wants you to be renewed in the Holy Ghost this morning. God wants you to be renewed in the Spirit today. God wants to show his kindness one more time by you throwing up your hands and saying, baptize me, Jesus. Baptize me again with the renewing. Anybody want a renewing of the Holy Ghost today? It's the kindness of God. It's the kindness of God that says, come on, you can get you some today. You can get a renewing of the Holy Ghost. Everybody in the church ought to say, God, I want a fresh anointing. I want a fresh touch. I want a fresh baptism. I want your kindness one more time. Oh, come on. Somebody ought to open their mouth and let the Holy Ghost baptize them. I'm talking about a renewing of the Holy Ghost. Oh, God in heaven. Oh, yes. That's what the Bible said. That's what the Bible said. But his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost. God, I want a renewing. Anybody with me this morning? God, I want a fresh touch of your Spirit in my life. I'm tired of living stale. I'm tired of living in routine. I'm tired of living dry. I'm tired of living dead. I'm tired of feeling like it's been a long time. I'm tired of feeling like I'm far from you, God. I want a renewing of the Holy Ghost. Is anybody hungry for another touch? Oh, come on. Is anybody hungry for another touch? Is anybody say, God, I need it one more time? I'm telling you, the kindness of God has come to his house today to give a renewing of the Holy Ghost to everybody that wants it. It's God's kindness. It's God's kindness. It's God's kindness that has moved in this house and said, you don't have to live off last year. You don't have to live. There is a renewing. You can be made brand new. Today, there's a fresh anointing. There's a fresh touch. There's a fresh baptism. There's a fresh move of the Spirit. There's a Holy Ghost revival moving in the house right now. There's a drawing of the Spirit on your heart. God wants to show. God wants to show. Oh, come on and pray. Come on and pray. Come on and reach out to God. There's a fresh baptism of the Spirit of the Lord in this place for you. There's a fresh anointing in this place for you. There's renewing. It's not, look, we understand. We preach the judgment of God. We know the judgment of God is real. We know the judgment of God. But just as real as there is the judgment of God, there is the kindness of God. And just as real as there is a judgment of God, the kindness of God is just as real and just as evident and just as powerful. The judgment of God is real, but the kindness of God has come today. Let's praise him. Everybody ought to lift your hands and say, God, baptize me with the regeneration, with the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost. Oh, come on, somebody. Come on, lift your voice and cry out, God, I need a renewing of the Holy Ghost today. God, I need a renewing of the Holy Ghost today. Oh, yes, Jesus. Oh, yes, Jesus.